Well, hello there and welcome to Park Congregational United Church of Christ, this open and affirming congregation in downtown Grand Rapids, Michigan. I'm so pleased you made some time in your busy lives to find this worshipful experience online and to join us on this Palm the Passion Sunday as we take these very first steps along a very sacred spiritual journey of walking with Christ through the parade in Jerusalem to the temple, to the upper room, to the washing of the feet and the sharing of the Last Supper, to prayers in Gethsemane, to the cross, all the way to the glory and the joy of the empty tomb. So thank you, my friends, for joining us on this Palm to Passion Sunday, and I hope that this will be a blessing unto you, this service, that the songs, the prayers, the story, the sharing of God's word will lift your hearts and fill your spirits. So as we gather on this last Sunday of Lent, on this Palm to Passion Sunday, I wanted to encourage you to find your way into the life and ministry of Park Congregational Church. You can do so by finding us online on our website or on Facebook or on Instagram. You can subscribe to our weekly newsletter and see how you can stay connected and be informed and get involved in our mission and our ministry here in West Michigan as well as around the world. But now, as we begin our worship and we come together, bound together by the love of the Holy Spirit, I invite you to open your hearts and your spirits to receive God's word on this immaculate and special day, Palm to Passion Sunday. Let us worship, my friends.
Thank you. there are three traditional Lenten disciplines that folks participate in during this high season. They are the disciplines of prayer, the discipline of fasting, and the discipline of almsgiving. You may or may not be aware that there has been three prayer circles of 22 folks here at Park Church who have covenanted every week of Lent to pray for every staff member, whether they are in the nursery or the senior minister, a choral scholar, or working the AV tech at, or in the office. Every staff member, every regular attendee of Park Church has been lifted up in prayer this season of Lent. You may not be aware that you have all, if you've been using the relentless Lenten devotionals, have been participating in a spiritual discipline of fasting. Each day there was a way for us to participate in doing less as a way to lean into what it means to fast and how that can lift our spirits and fill our hearts in this kind of paradoxical way. And then, of course, we were partnering with our mission partner, Cherry Health, in creating and donating alms through these dental kits for children and for adults, and through raising funds for their dental health clinic. And we are so pleased to say that we've reached our goal, but if you would still like to make a donation to Cherry Health, you may do so at the offering or by using the QR code in your bulletin. And I want to say a great deal of thanks to those who came on the Lenten Wednesday night to put these dental kits together. We are about to dedicate them and consecrate them before they head off to Cherry Health so that they may reach the people who are in need of them this day. And of course, we continue to pray for Israel and Gaza, for Ukraine. And today we also hold our kindred and our neighbors in Russia after the terror attack. We continue to pray for our neighbors in Haiti in the midst of that tumultuous civil war. We pray for the Congo, the Republic of Congo, and particularly for our good friend Sebastian Kaposha, our member here who is Congolese. And that's not just the headline, the civil war in the Republic of Congo. It is affecting his family, his friends, those who he loves so dearly. So we hold the people of Congo in our prayer as well. So my friends, I would invite you now to go with me in a word of prayer as we dedicate these alms and we lift up our prayers to our loving God, who covenants with us to not only hear our prayers, but to be active in the answering of them this day. Steadfast God, Lent is a long journey. And now as we enter Holy Week, we can see the shadow of the cross, even as we follow in the footsteps of Jesus at the gates of Jerusalem. We have arrived on this Palm Sunday, but we know the journey is just started. There is still a deeper journey to make. And so we must retrace the footsteps of Christ from parade to cross to empty tomb. For the whole point of this spiritual journey is to connect more deeply with you and each other and this beautiful world. And it is to awaken our souls to the suffering of our world and to have the courage to respond to it with a Christ-like compassion. So in that spirit of God, we bring before you this day our Lenten alms that we have collected for our partners at Cherry Health. We ask that these gifts of money and dental kits would be consecrated and blessed so that they would reach those who are in need of dental care. Be with our friends over at Cherry Health. Bless the staff and the volunteers so that they may be agents of your healing grace and vessels of your mercy. Let those who receive your care know your abiding presence. And we thank you for those who gave so generously. And we commit ourselves this day through these alms to be a continued source of hope and compassion for our community. O God, grant us wisdom and grant us courage for the living of these days. And help us soothe the cries of those who grieve. Help us to remember and honor those who have died. Help us to beat our guns and bombs and spears and all instruments of war and death so that they may be transformed into instruments of life and peace. Like Christ, May we offer dignity to those we meet. Like Christ, may we act out for justice, and may we love mercy, and may we always walk humbly with you. And like Christ, may we always hope, even in the face of seemingly overwhelming, senseless hopelessness. Oh God, we pray these words, for they are not merely the words of our mouths and the meditations of our spirits, but they are our heart's desires. And so we turn inward to find you, and there we find courage and insight and strength. There we find the endurance to share Christ's love and allow the Holy Spirit to work in and through us this day. So hear our prayers, O God. Incline your ear to us, for we bring these prayers, both spoken aloud and that rest silently upon our lips, in the name of your Son, Christ Jesus, our rock and our Redeemer. For he taught us to bring everything to you in prayer when he taught us these ancient and sacred words to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture reading today for this Palm to Passion Sunday is found in the Gospel according to Mark. I'll be reading from the 11th chapter, verses 1 through 11. Listen for the word of God for you this day, for God is still speaking. When Jesus and his disciples were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say, 'The Lord needs it,' and we'll send it back here immediately." They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. Here ends our reading. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
The largest pride parade in the state of California is not hosted by Los Angeles. It's not hosted by San Francisco. It's hosted by the great city of San Diego. Nearly 300,000 people attend the Pride Parade in the neighborhood of Hillcrest in San Diego, California. And though it is exhausting for an introvert like myself to be surrounded by 300,000 other people, I love the Pride Parade. And I participated in it every single year I lived in San Diego. Because there is no more joyous event than Pride. And it really is a family affair in every sense of that word. And the Pride Parade in San Diego starts the exact same way every single year. In the pole position, situated at the very front, is a contingent of lesbians on motorcycles, or as they are registered as a 501c3 under the moniker, this is their name, not mine, Dykes on Bikes. Yes, that is correct. And these sisters ride their motorcycle to kick off the parade every year. And right behind them, in the second position, breathing in all of that exhaust, are the clergy. Ministers, rabbis, priests, gurus, shamans, we're all decked out in our vestments and our collars and our prayer shawls. We're Jewish, we're Christian, we're Muslim, we're Unitarian, we're Sikh, we're Buddhist, we're Hindu, we're tribal, we're spiritualist. We come from all different denominations and faith traditions, and the clergy get to go even before the grand marshal of the parade. And they do that, they put the clergy up front for a very strategic reason. It's all very much planned out. The clergy are placed in such a prominent position to be a symbol of solidarity and to dispel this notion that somehow it has gotten out there that being a person of faith is inherently contradictory to supporting LGBTQ equality. And the interfaith clergy who walk in the San Diego Pride Parade, we organize ourselves under the banner Faith for Freedom. Listen to what my very good friend, the Reverend Mary Sue Brookshire, said in an interview that she gave with a local news station as to why Faith for Freedom is the name we chose. Faith, she says, plays a vital role in the lives of so many people, including the LGBTQ community. And as leaders of faith, we acknowledge that protecting religious freedom means protecting LGBTQ rights, not chipping away at them. All of us, she goes on to say, are part of one body, as the Apostle Paul says. So when one part of the body suffers, we all suffer. When one part of the body rejoices, we all rejoice. But sadly, the Christian church has inflicted suffering on its own body through the ways that we have harmed the LGBTQ community. But on Pride, we come together as people of different religions, as people of different backgrounds, to celebrate the ways that our faith unites us in freedom, in love, and in justice for all. Way to go, Mary Sue. So every year, after the Dykes on Bikes kick off the San Diego Pride Parade with this loud procession of revved up motorcycles expelling copious amounts of CO2 into the atmosphere, the interfaith reverends and rabbis walk in a much more subdued way, waving our little rainbow flags and offering prayers to those who would like to pray for us, with us. We pray for anyone, our neighbors, their families, their allies. And the clergy are put in the Pride Parade for a very strategic reason. They are put up front because it's all planned out. It makes a statement. And it's all done for faith and freedom. Faith and freedom. That was probably on the forefront of the mind of the one who strategically planned a parade that took place nearly 2,000 years ago on the east side of Jerusalem. Now, we modern-day people here at Park Church today, we might not know that Jesus and his disciples weren't on spring break. They weren't just taking a vacation and road-tripping their way down to Jerusalem. They were there on purpose. They were there for a purpose. They were there for the Passover festival. Now, all four Gospels tell us the story of what we call Palm Sunday. But the version that Gregg read for us from the Gospel of Mark tells us very specifically that Jesus planned this whole thing out. He was very intentional. He did everything with forethought. This wasn't some spur-of-the-moment thing. He thought of everything ahead of time, and he did so for the purpose of making a statement on purpose. So let's not be naive. Jesus knew exactly what he was doing. He turned this parade, this palm parade, into a parable. It was like Jesus was saying, "What shall I compare the kingdom of God to?" The kingdom of God is like a parade. And Jesus took his cues from the Hebrew prophet Zechariah, who proclaimed nearly 800 years prior to Jesus that God's reign of peace would begin when a new sovereign entered Jerusalem on the back of a donkey colt. And this newly divine appointed ruler would banish all war. He would overthrow oppressive regimes, and he would gather to himself people, and people would live in peace with one another. And I'm telling you, I firmly believe that Jesus staged his palm parade on purpose. And he did so in direct contrast with another parade that just happened to be taking place on the exact same day in Jerusalem. Perhaps you know about this other parade, but if you don't, or if you need a refresher, well, let me tell you. You see, every year, the festival of Passover, thousands of pilgrims would come to Jerusalem to celebrate this festival. Jerusalem would be overflowing, bloated with visitors. And the Passover festival, if you don't know, is a celebration when the Jewish people remember how God liberated them and granted them freedom from the oppressive regime of Egypt. You know who knew what Passover was all about? Rome. Rome knew Passover backwards and forwards. And just to make sure that the Jewish people didn't get any big ideas about fighting for their freedom against another empire anytime soon, the Judean Roman governor, Pontius Pilate, would come to Jerusalem every Passover just to keep the peace. He would march from Caesarea Maritima, from the west coast of Palestine, right on the Mediterranean Sea, and he would enter Jerusalem from the west via its largest gate. And he would ride a war horse, a stallion, and he would be followed by cavalry and soldiers and banners and troops, all marching in time. This was all staged. It was all very strategic. And it was to make a very specific statement on purpose. All of Jerusalem could not miss the point being made. You celebrate Passover only at the tolerant pleasure of Rome. Then on the other side of town, Jesus rode in on the back of a donkey colt down from the Mount of Olives. And he was surrounded by a crowd of everyday, ordinary citizens, children and women and men, old and young, middle-aged and adolescent. These folks threw their cloaks on the road and they took palm branches and waved them in the air. Small children were lifted up on the shoulders of their parents as they greeted Jesus with the shouts, "Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David." You see the difference, right? One city, two parades, One, a display of Rome's imperial might. The other, a parable of faith and freedom. One, a demonstration of what the kingdom of God is like. One parade marched into the city to the drumbeat of war. The other entered Jerusalem to people crying out, "Hosanna! Hosanna! Hosanna!" Which, when translated from the Hebrew into English, gets translated as, "Save us! Save us now!" You see, Hosanna isn't just some simple cheer. It's not some slogan. It's not a marketing campaign. It's a prayer. It's a plea. Save us. Now, I'm not talking about the salvation that comes as a get-out-of-jail-free card, some pass that gets you into heaven or hell based on what you believe or don't believe. That's a twisted version of biblical salvation. Rather, the salvation that Jesus is offering people is, as the good sister Joan Chittister writes, the salvation of God, for which the God of the Bible yearns, is not a sacrificial atonement, but a love inspired at-one-ment. God yearns, Sister Joan says, for the healing of the whole creation, for the reconciling of humanity, not only to God, but also the reconciliation of one to another and with the whole earth. God's salvation, biblical salvation, is the complete reordering of the world so that people may finally live united in freedom and in peace. That's why the people raise their voices that very first Palm Parade. It's why we raise our voice today. Hosanna, Hosanna, save us, O God. Save us from ourselves. Save us from our violent tendencies. Save us from our penchant for greed and gluttony. Save us from our fears and save us from our shame. Save us from our tribalism and our partisan ways. Save us, O God, from our grief and our despair. Save us, O God, from our broken relationships and our petty jealousies. Save us, O God, from our isolation and our loneliness. Save us, O God, from scapegoating others and playing the victim card. Save us, O God. Save us from ourselves and what we do to each other. Well, I've got good news for you. God hears our prayers. But this is where the good news gets tricky. Because the good news is that God does indeed save us. And yet, the way that God goes about saving us is not the way that any one of us would have expected. Jesus doesn't go around vanquishing his enemies, nor does he become the victim to them. Rather, Jesus breaks the cycle of sin and violence. He does so through sacrifice, through service, through forgiveness. He saves by never wavering for who God called him to be, even though that faithfulness and that determination to the way of God's love and truth, faith and freedom will lead him to a cross, to his own murder. Listen to what the Reverend Dr. Barbara Brown Taylor speaks of Jesus's saving work and what she calls Jesus's obituary. Dr. Brown Taylor writes, "It's an old, old story. Love comes into the world as a little child, fresh from God. And when love grows up, love feeds people, love heals people. Love turns things upside down, and love's actions do not set well with the people in charge. They warn love to leave well enough alone. Love meets hate, love meets politics, love meets fear, and love goes on loving, which gets love killed. not by villains in black hats, but by people like us, clergy, patriots, God-fearing folk. What brought them together was their rage at him for being less than they wanted him to be, or for being more than they wanted him to be, but in any case, for not being who they wanted him to be. And they killed him for it. But surprise, surprise, love goes on loving. And love won't stay dead, because love once born can never truly die. And through love's resurrection, Jesus breaks the system and the cycle of violence and vengeance, and he writes a new story of grace and hope that he then invites us to participate in through being actors and agents in this story. He writes a story of how love will lead us from death to life and from falsehood to truth, from despair to hope, from fear to trust. He rewrites the story that's being told through the events and the rituals, the songs and the prayers of Holy Week. A week that starts off with a parade, a parable of a parade that teaches us what the kingdom of God is like. And he stages this parade for a very specific purpose. It's very strategic. It's on purpose, and the message is clear. God will save us through love. And God saves us so we may live a life of love. And that's the good news. But before I say amen, let me add a very short postscript. When you get to the end of the San Diego Pride Parade, you end up in a park, and you get a chance to stand in some shade and drink some water, and the participants in the parade get to mingle and chat. And for a moment, the only people in the park at the end of the parade route, at the very beginning, are the members of Dykes on Bike and the clergy. And that makes a very odd couple. They are really a paradox. But there's a blessing to be found in paradox. And I will always remember a very brief conversation I had with a woman named Betsy. She walked up to me and said, "Hi, I really like your scarf." And I said, "You mean this?" "Thank you, but this is a stole, not a scarf. I mean, but whatever, thank you." And she said, and I said, "It's nice to meet you. I like your motorcycle." And she said, "You mean that? I mean, that's not a motorcycle, that's a chopper, but whatever, thank you." Then after a very awkward moment that I created, she said, "I'm Betsy." And I said, "I'm Darryl. Wasn't today fun?" And she said, "It was more than fun, it was important. It means a lot to me and my sisters that you and your minister friends walk in the parade. Because there's a lot of us who think that ministers don't like us, that we're their enemy. I've met a lot of ministers, and they usually hate me. But here you are walking in the parade. You're rewriting the story, one that I think desperately needs to be rewritten. You might not think it's a big deal, but it's a big deal. You might just think you're walking in a silly parade, but each step you take, it might save someone's life. And that's a really big deal. Because you're showing us that you love us, that God loves us. And for that, I want to say thank you." And then Betsy gave me the biggest bear hug, and she was so strong, I thought she was gonna break me in half. Good people, you might think today was just a silly little parade. Children waving palms, it was super cute. But it was more than that. It was a parade about faith, about freedom, about love and hope. It was about our hosannas, about God saving us from ourselves, saving us through God's love, saving us so that we may live a life of love. And that's a big deal. And it's the good news this day. Amen. My friends, today is the very beginning of Holy Week, and I want to invite you to go on a journey with Jesus to the temple, to overturn the tables of the money changers and that oppressive economic system that was bearing down on ordinary people, to the upper room where he gathers with his friends to show us what servant love looks like and to bless a ritual that will sustain us through the hardest of times, to the Garden of Gethsemane where he lays bare his fears and he leans into the faith that God's will be done, where he's then arrested and tried and convicted, though he is innocent, and he dies on a cross. But that's not the end of the story, for love once born can never truly die. But walking with Jesus through Holy Week and his passion can make Easter's joy that much more profound. So I want to invite you to come to all of the worship services, the rites, the rituals, the prayers, to lift the songs that this week, so that you may journey with Christ as he walks through his lonesome valley. May God bless this time, this high, holy time of commemorating and remembering the passion of Jesus. So won't you take a moment and add your hearts to mine as we go to God in a word of prayer, asking for God's blessing to be upon our Holy Week. Oh God, as we journey this week with Christ to the cross and to the empty tomb, remind us that we are not alone in our suffering and sorrow. Give us bold yet humble faith. Open our hearts to Christ's passion, to his suffering and his sorrow, that we may find wisdom and strength to face our own trials, and we may be a help to others as they face theirs. This we pray in your Son's holy name, and all of God's children said, Amen.
Good people, our worship service on this Palm to Passion Sunday is coming to a close. And I do hope that the words, the songs, the prayers, this opportunity to participate in this Palm Parade with Christ has been a blessing unto you. And I want you to seriously consider accepting the invitation to walk with Christ through this Holy Week, so that your hearts may experience the passion of Christ, but also so it can be prepared to receive the joy and the gift of Easter. There are many ways for you to do that, and I hope that you will choose to do so. But now on this Palm to Passion Sunday, and as our worship does come to a close, I also want to invite you, wherever you may be at this moment, to lift up aloud or just silently to yourself the words of our common commission, so that we may write them on our hearts, so that we may live them out as agents of Christ in our community and in our world this day. Let us now go forth into the world in peace, being of good courage, holding fast to that which is good, rendering to no one evil for evil, strengthening the faint-hearted, supporting the weak, helping the afflicted, honoring all people, loving and serving the Lord, and rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Friends, our Palm to Passion Sunday worship service has come to an end. Let us go with God. Let us go in peace. Amen and amen.